Hi Meghdeep.
Hi.
Welcome back.
Thank you.
So today we are here to learn some important tips and tricks from you, which will help the viewers make less mistakes in their sessions when they are sending them to the mix engineers. And I hope the mix engineers will appreciate your effort.
Yes.
And that will help raise the bar in this whole process. So over to you.
Okay. So I'll be taking you through the process of finalizing your mix session and the basic do's and don'ts before you send out a session to the mix engineer, to whomsoever you're giving the mix. Here are a few things that you can follow. So I'll be taking you through a song that I produced 3 years back. It's a song for MS Dhoni. It's called Besabriyaan, and this is the final compile of everything that's on the song. Although it's very less tracks right now, it's hardly 55 tracks for an open project. You can see the vocals over here. So I'll straight away hit on the grouping part where I group the tracks. Now this is a dummy vocal. Although Arman sings a dummy vocal also as his final. These are the dummy vocals. The way we saw Aditya Pushkarna in his video defining every group by a color code. So I can color it, say orange, you know, I can basically, so I know that these are the vocals that I need to bounce into one. Because these are not the final vocals, I don't have a reverb delay map on this, on these vocals. So I'll bounce them into vocals dummy 3. And I'll include the FXs so that the mix engineer, whoever is mixing that track, would have an idea of the reverb and delay, or at least the space for which, around which I produced the track. So now instead of sending these three different bifurcations, I will pre-mix all these three things into one track. So the mix engineer receives just this one track, and it's easier for him to, you know, attack the files. Now, there's this arpish sort of thing. So what I'll do is I will identify different aspects of this arrangement. You know, for example, there's this piano. So you can club these two into one because it's one instrument playing different parts. So if I start with arpeggiators, so I will club all the arp elements, which at the moment are only in these two. So I'll premix these two into one. So as you see, I'm reducing the scope of engineer falling into those pits where he's trying to group what you've sent, you know. So instead of sending wild bifurcations of everything on the track, I would send him my intention towards the production, that these are two elements that need to play in sync. You can see a syncopation between these two. Same goes for pianos. So I've got a grand piano and I've got an electric piano. And then this piano over here. These three could be clubbed into, that's the basic riff. And because these two instruments belong to the same family, I can always club them. Basically, you find that these three instruments are within the same family and the same registers. I premix them into one. So we started with around 55 tracks, and I expect to bounce all of that down to say maybe 16 or 20 tracks or something. So as you can see, all these muted elements, now they're all becoming a part of the upper stack of the acoustic guitars. So usually when it's acoustic guitars, I let the fret and the body microphone go separately because I want the engineer to have an upper hand on it. But then you have the other things over here where you have the same pluck family. As I've often mentioned that I love unison, where different instruments are playing the same part. So this is one guitar part which is played by three different patches, two different patches. And they create a color like this. So I send all of these guys into, and there's this one guitar part over here that, so you bring all of them into, okay, that's an acoustic guitar. So I'll premix electric guitar pre-1, because there could be other electric guitars playing different parts, so I've named it EG part pre-1. There you go. So the electric guitars, all the pluck electric guitars are a part of first pre. I put these guys into this. Now come the horns. I can color them maybe, say, this. I don't know the color names, but yeah. So I bring all of them. So the whole idea is to bring down. Now if you imagine a horn section playing this, you won't have a separate mic for every horn. You may record them as an ensemble, and you just have two mics recording four horns or something like that. So you send the premix that way, where you bounce it as a section and not as an individual instruments. That goes as this. So we've got horns. You've got a guitar solo. So basically I'll try to collect all the solos that are there in the song. This is the first music. And what I usually do is I go on and I progress muting every premix I've done. So I've muted all the sections that I've premixed so far. So now you can hear the parts that are left out. So you know that this is what is left out and we need to address that section. Now as I see that here I've got a guitar. You can see that these are two different guitars. Because we wanted a different sound in the antara, so I leave this guitar as it is. And if I see that if there's any other bifurcation that I can premix this guitar into, I'll attack that. Let's go for the string section. We have... Now there's this interesting combination over here where I have live and programmed strings together, and so the challenge comes where you need to blend in the programmed strings. Now when we were doing dhoni, we didn't have basses and cellos live, so these were the programmed strings. And we had the live violins playing the staccatos. So we clubbed both of them. this becomes one section, one part of the arrangement where there's one particular bifurcation of a style of playing. So this is staccato. So I can actually take the liberty of premixing these into one. These are my programmed strings. Okay, so I'll exclude this because this is a legato part. Again, a staccato part. So I'll color all of these parts together, maybe say red. I'll premix all of them as strings staccato. So basically the engineer knows that where the staccatos are coming in from. As you can see, I've added a space designer over here. I've passed them through the bus. And I don't want to premix my strings within that with that reverb because I want the engineer to have a freedom of that. So I've basically bounced all of it without the reverb. So you can feel the presence. The engineer can add his own space to it and basically glue it to the song. Then I'll take all the legato parts of strings, which are these, and I'll club all of them into one. As you can see, all legato parts. So that I can always get back to that section. Legato, strings. Again, the live violins, I had given them a different space, which I have bypassed and bounced all of them into one. And then I take all the bounced parts right up in the session. I mute these two and bring up. So now I know what all things I've excluded of the mix. Now I've got three flutes over here. So basically, you are reducing the engineer's efforts to find. Now, as I can see, I've missed out a viola part over here. So now, because I've missed it out, I'll go back to the stack that I premixed. I'll open it up. Sorry. So, as you remember, we had all of these as the legato ones. Now, this is what we often come across while premixing our tracks, that we've already premixed something. But as you can see, that these viola parts, if those viola parts don't overlap the parts in the string section, you can always bounce them and place them in the premix. But right now, as you can see, it's a part of the arrangement. So I'll have to rebounce it. And just the way I have made a mistake, everybody can. So I'm just telling you the remedy, that you can always go back to the, you color correct it. First of all, give it the right color. There you go. You select all the elements that were legato. Now you know that. I'll double check with my session if I've missed out anything, which I don't see. And yeah, and most importantly, legato strings. Now it'll rename it as one, because we already have one legato strings file. I'll delete the previous one, keep this, there you go. Now I've got the base. Now as you can see, the base is just one, there's just one bass guitar, and we had Rushad who played one phrase in the second music. So I'll see if it's clashing with, no, it's not. It's not overlapping my bass parts. So the entire song had my synthetic bass, and we had Rushad to play that part in second music. So this is the entire bass. Now instead of giving two tracks, I'll send it as one. Bass guitars. That becomes one track for us. And that's how you go with every section. So as you can see, we are substantially lowering down the number of tracks that we are about to send out. You have two hats over here. So now, because I liked the open hats of some other patch and I liked the closed hat of some other patch, so I had used two different patches over there for hats, which I'll premix into one again. So the principle of it is basically including as many tracks as possible with the least bifurcation, like more detail within less bifurcation, so that the engineer is at a lot of comfort recognizing sections. And this is a sidechained organ which we can come later to. So here I've used claps as a part of the snare arrangement. So when I was producing this track, I decided to use claps instead of snare. So the snare parts are now claps. We've got this. So I'll basically club, snare, stick and claps into one. And check what's this over here. These are tones, alright. So claps plus snare. Pull it off. Then, as I said earlier, that the electric guitar may have a different style of playing. Here are the power chords. That's our beloved Ankur playing the guitars. I'll bounce all the power chords. Do one. There you go. Now the snare over here is It's not a drum snare part, but it's more of an orchestral snare, and so I have not included it into the drum mix. As I said earlier, that I've included snare claps together. I have not included this part because I've written it as an orchestral snare part and not as a drum snare. So I let this part go the way it is. You hear? There's the guitar solo. Now what I've done is, there's this guitar solo over here, which I've played. I'll club it with all the solo electric guitar parts. So as you can see, there's no overlapping. Here's this is one part which is counted as one. Also because Ankur played it in a particular balance, you know, over my solo. So this is what I had played at my studio, the main solo. And Ankur very wisely didn't let any of his guitar parts clash over mine. And so he kept these elements hanging in there. So I'll basically solo guitar, solo electric. Okay, wait, I'm missing on one more. Correct. So here I'm bringing down some four tracks of electric guitars into one. So it's all about bringing different nature of sounds or maybe arrangements into different groups and making the mix more approachable, making the session more accessible, more tangible. Because usually what happens is the mix engineer spends one entire day just sorting out what's playing where, you know. Still, this is a very pop arrangement, but when we consider hybrid arrangements where there are huge orchestral tracks coming in, where there are blends of Indian rhythms and pop elements coming together, it becomes really tough for the engineer to, or not tough, but actually very time consuming for the engineer to get in and sort parts. So there you go. This is the next remix. The kick remains the same, the cymbals go the way they are, the sidechain organ goes the way it is. Alright, so I've got a different kick over here. I'm sorry, I did this song 3 years back, so I don't remember much. So I've got two kicks here, which I'll premix V. This was Ankur's addition on my riff. I don't see any other thing, so this goes as banjolin. This is shaker. So now if we go back and check what we have remixed, if I delete all of this from the session, we have actually brought the session down to half of the tracks. You know, we started with 55 tracks, we are now at 25. You know, and that too leaving out a lot of drum mix out there and, you know, things like that. So just having these many tracks, you know, an engineer feels the mix to be more simple, more approachable, you know, and it helps the engineer to really get onto the mix, you know, understand what parts are there, what not, and everything. That's, and of course, why we color coded those things is because we know that if an engineer wants a bifurcation of particular elements, we can always go back to that color coding and give him that. You know. So that's why we color coded the string section, because we knew that those things are supposed to be included in that. You know. And one important thing, one last thing before you send the session, always watch the headroom that you have over here. So right now it's not clipping over here. Otherwise, if you see your session giving out signals like this, still not giving out because so you can see the clip here. Sometimes we give the engineer the files with a clip of 10 dB, 12 dB happening on the master clip, which is very, very, very unhealthy, you know. So you always need to select everything together, bring it down, all the faders down, so that you have a decent headroom. Oh, see, you can see the headroom breathing now, you know. So yeah, so it's all about making your engineer comfortable and feel him, make him feel at ease, and you know, then begin working with. And of course, there'll be further groupings that will be done by the engineer. You know, he may put all of these guitars onto one bus. You know, he may put the strings all together on one bus. You know, he may put the basses and maybe the kick and bass. Sometimes the engineers try to glue the mix by putting the bass and the kick on the same bus. You know. So this is how, in my opinion, the files should be sent out to a mix engineer, because why I have premixed them within the DAW is also because I wanted to keep my summing as close as possible as it was in my mix, and also because we don't know what DAW the engineer would work on. It could be Pro Tools, it could be Cubase. Some engineers work right away from Logic itself. But yes, I think it's all about keeping an engineer at a comfortable place, and letting him have equal freedom, despite of the fact that you premix a lot of stuff and send it to him. So yeah, I hope this is helpful. This was helpful, and all of you who are watching this would follow. And rather, you know, you can also innovate your methods of you know, grouping tracks and finding out. Also remembering that every song is different. So not every song would have violins, not every song would have drums. So it differs from song to song. So it's all about bringing the same nature of instruments or bringing the same arrangement together. So if as I showed that the strings are playing staccato, If the entire string section is playing the staccato, bring it together. You know. So you can always bounce staccato and legato parts separately. If snare and clap are playing together, you can always bounce them together if you want that balance to be the same even after the mix. So yeah, these pointers, and I think they should be really helpful and useful for everybody who is looking for having a basic idea on how to send your session for the mix. And please mind the nomenclature. It's very important that you name the tracks correctly. It really helps the engineer. Thank you.